Good morning, First Assembly. We're glad to have you in the house of the Lord. On this Mother's Day, can we all stand together all over the room? Would you put your hands together if you're glad to know the Lord and you're glad to be in His house with His saints, with His believers? This is amazing grace. Can we worship Him this morning together?
Stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with a holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Everybody lift your voice and say it.
This is amazing grace. This is a very love. Where you take my place, where you wear my glory, you lay down your life, that I would be
with us.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Yeah. This is amazing grace. Lay down your life.
Let's bless the Lord. Let's bless the Lord. You are great and greatly to be praised. You turn graves into gardens. You turn seas into highways. I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures of fame are never enough. And you came along. You put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Oh. Listen. See, I'm not afraid to show you my weakness, my failures and flaws. Lord, you've seen them all. You still call me friend.
Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find.
Come on, lift your voice with us and say, you turn mourning. Everybody say it now.
You turn mourning to dancing. You give beauty for ashes. You turn shame into glory. You're the only one who can.
You turn mourning, say.
You turn mourning.
Nothing is better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. Everybody, everybody.
Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing.
There's nothing
better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you.
Shout it out. You turn graves.
You turn graves into gardens. You turn bones into armies. You turn seas into highways. You're the
one who can turn our mourning into dancing. You can turn graves into gardens. You turn seas into highways. And it's because of that, it's because of that, that we can sing, we know that you're trustworthy. How many of you know that he is trustworthy? He is faithful. Everybody in the room ought to know this one. It's an old hymn. I want you to join us as we sing, "'Tis So Sweet."
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust.
Sing with us.
Thank you.
Come on, just worship him right now. Just worship him right now. Not one word has ever failed of all that he promised to do. His promises are yes and amen. Yes and so be it. Yes. And let it be done. Whatever it is that you need to trust him with this morning, can you just lift up your heart, lift up your voice, lift up your hands and say, Lord, I give it to you. I trust you with it. I take from you life and joy and peace. I take from you rest. I take from you hope. I receive from you everything that I need. He's Jehovah Jireh. He's Jehovah Rapha. He's Jehovah Nisi. He's Jehovah Tsidkenu. He's Jehovah Shammah. He's Jehovah everything. He's Jehovah everything that you need this morning. I'm going to ask Pastor Scott and Becca to come. Butch, would you mind joining us up here today? And we're going to give you some time right now. If you need prayer, you want somebody to pray the prayer of faith with you, to agree with you in prayer. Our worship team, we kind of want to just disappear right now and provide you with just a little bit of atmosphere where you can come and pray and believe God for your needs this morning. So whatever it is that you need, we're going to make room for the Lord right now to minister to you. You can come right now if you want somebody to join with you in prayer, physical, spiritual, financial, whatever it may be. As we worship, this is your opportunity to come and make your request known unto the Lord and to these prayer partners. And they'll agree with you in prayer this morning. The rest of us, can we just lift our voices softly all over the room? And let's say this together.
Here is where I live.
Every burden, every crown.
This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay down every lie and every doubt. This is my surrender.
Sing it out, I will make. I will make room.
I will make room for you to do whatever you want to do whatever you want to.
While these folks are being ministered to, can the rest of us just worship him right now? Can we just magnify him? All over the room, find your own words. Find your own voice. Find your own expression. And let's just worship him. Let's just worship him. Right here, right now. Right here, right now. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Shake up the ground of our tradition. Shake up the ground, break down the walls. Come on, let's sing it together now.
Shake up the ground of all my tradition, break down the walls of all my religion. Your way is better.
Your way.
Your way is better. Shake up the ground of all my tradition, break down the walls of all my religion.
Over the room. Where I lay it down, say,
here is where I lay it down. You are all I'm chasing now. This is my surrender. This is my surrender. Here is where I lay it down. You are all I'm chasing now. This is my surrender.
Hallelujah. Let this be one big altar. Let this sanctuary space be one big altar this morning, where we lay it all down and we we say, do what you want to. Individually, corporately, do what you want to this morning. Like one big choir all over the room, let's say, have thine own way, Lord. Sing it. Have thine own way. Thou art the Sing it out. Mold me. Mold me and make me after thy will. Why? Come on, everybody, sing it one more time. Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Thou art the potter. Thou art the potter. I am the clay. I am the clay. Make it a prayer right now. Mold me and make me. Mold me and make me after thy will. Why? Say, mold me and make me. Mold me and make me after thy will. Why?
When you took us back a little ways there with that song, I remember standing in church as a kid as we sang that song, and the altars would fill up. God's presence would just be in the place. God desires to have that same experience with us today, right here in this place today. Lord, if we'd just open up our hearts to Him. Just open up our hearts to Him and allow Him to do that work in us today. Amen. Well, today is a special day. It's Mother's Day. We want to say happy Mother's Day to all of our moms out there today. And I hope that you're able to have an opportunity to be with your kids today. And kids, I'm encouraging you to be with your moms today and reach out and make sure you make contact with them. Our moms are so special to us, and they deserve all the honor that we can give them. Amen. We have several that are in need of prayer this morning. We have some that are in rehab stages. Clyde T. is still recovering from her surgery. Cecilia Millsaps is now at Atrium in Charlotte going through rehab. Janet Green had surgery on her foot, and she is in rehab as well. Let's remember Janet. That's a very painful surgery that she had to go through. But we also want to remember this morning James Montgomery. And many of you have already reached out. You've been praying. James had an episode at school where they had to rush him to the hospital, and he's still in the hospital right now. They're doing some additional testing on him, making sure that they know exactly what's taking place. But let's just pray for James this morning. He especially needs a miracle from God in his life today. And we need to pray that the doctors have wisdom to know exactly what it is they're looking for, to pinpoint that the situation in his body that has caused him to have this episode. So let's pray for James and Lisa today as well. Also, let's pray for our pastor, Dennis, as he is in Israel. Pray that God will continue to surround him, keep him safe. But I'm sure he's having a blast. And but let's just keep him in our prayers, that God gives him safety while he's there and as he returns home to us. Amen. Let's just pray this morning. Father, we thank you, God, for your amazing love to our lives. And we thank you, Father, for your grace, Lord, that you poured out to us. I pray, God, that we would not take for granted the grace of God in our lives today, Lord. We do lift up these that are in need of prayer, Cecilia Millsaps and Janet Green and Clyte Smith. Lord, we pray that you'll continue to strengthen them, encourage them, Lord, as they go through this time of rehabilitation in their bodies today. Lord, we pray for James Montgomery this morning, Lord. We pray for a miracle in his life today in the name of Jesus, Father. Lord, you know exactly what is taking place there, and we just pray, God, that you'll give wisdom and direction to those that are attending to him. God, that they'll know exactly how to care for him. But Lord, most of all, we lean on you. We know that you are the great physician, and only you can touch and bring healing to our bodies in Jesus' name, Lord. I pray the peace of God over James and Lisa today and his family. Lord, that you'll give them peace to know, God, that you are directing their footsteps. And we just believe you, God, that you cause all things to work together, Lord. And we just are calling upon you today, Lord, to touch and minister in Jesus' name. We pray for Pastor Dennis today, God, as he is in Israel. Lord, continue to protect him and keep him safe in every place he goes. But Lord, I pray that you'll just fill him up with those events that he's experiencing right now, Lord, that just those places where you have walked, and Father, that he would just be inspired and motivated, and God, that he'll be encouraged in all that he does. Keep him safe as he travels back as well, in Jesus' name. And Lord, in this place today, I pray that you and you alone will be honored and glorified in all that we do. God, I thank you for your Holy Spirit that is real in this place this morning. I give you praise for it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated today. If our ushers will come to receive the morning tithes and offerings, we want to worship God and giving of our tithes this morning. Let's thank the Lord for these gifts this morning. Father, we do thank you for all that you've given to us, Lord. You blessed us in so many ways. Thank you, God, for your hand upon our lives. Lord, that you minister to us in so many ways. God, your grace is so real. We pray, God, for these offerings that are coming today, God. We pray, Lord, that you'll bless them, multiply them. Lord, we pray that we will be able to do the work that you've called us to do, God. Lord, bless those that give today and meet their every need, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you as you give this morning. I want to welcome our guests today. If you're a first-time guest with us, or maybe it's been a long time since you've been with us at First Assembly, we thank you for being here today. And immediately following the service, well, let me back up a second. In the pew back in front of you, there are connection cards. They're the long cards in front of the tithing envelopes. If you'll take one of those, fill it out, and at the conclusion of the service, I'll be in the cafe right outside the doors here. And if you would just bring that card to me, I'd love to meet with you and just give you a gift, a token of our appreciation for being with us here today at First Assembly. Amen. Got a couple of announcements. Do not forget about the meal that's taking place right after our service today. It's going to be in the cafeteria today, and all the proceeds from this meal are going to go towards helping our youth get to youth camp and our kids to get to kids camp. So thank you so much for coming and being a part of that. Also, next Friday, this coming Friday, I should say. Our seniors are meeting down in the cafeteria, down in the school, I should say, and that'll be at 6:30. And there's a special guest that's going to be there, so special that they wouldn't even tell me who it was. So you want to come and find out who this mystery guest is. Amen. Thank you. Pastor Derwin.
Thank you, Pastor Scott. And I just want to say again how delighted we are to have you with us this morning on this Mother's Day in the house of the Lord. I wish all of you could have met my mom. She's been gone. Her last Mother's Day on earth was 1992. And I was actually preaching a youth camp in Kinley, North Carolina. And Pastor Dennis was there when I got the call that my mom had gone to be with the Lord. And so she's just an amazing lady. Amazing, number one, that she had 11 children. 6 girls and 5 boys. And she was 43 when I was born. Wonderful memories of my mom early in the morning and late at night, calling every one of our names to the Lord in prayer. She was a godly lady. And I remember her and honor her today. And I want to ask Becca to come. She's going to minister to us today, and I want you to show appreciation for her as she comes to teach the word of the Lord. We love you, and I know you're going to have a wonderful word for us this morning.
All right. Yes, I can. Well, welcome. In case you guys don't know who I am, because there might be some friends here who have joined us, my name is Becca Boyce. I am the pastor's wife. Pastor Dennis is not here today. He does send his greetings from Israel. He is having a wonderful time there, and he's just so grateful for the opportunity to be there. But I do think that he is a little sad that he is not here with us today to, join with us during Mother's Day. But he is watching online. I don't even know where the camera is, but wherever that is. Oh, there it is. I just can't see because of the lights. I know he said that he was going to probably get back into the room in enough time to watch online. But if he isn't, I'm sure he will later. I love you, honey. I miss you. And so just thank you so much for all of your prayers. I know that you guys have been praying for him very much, and praying for his safety and his health, and just the fact that he will be able to really enjoy the opportunity to walk where Jesus walked, to see things that are described in the Bible with words that he can see face to face. And so I am so happy and thankful he gets that opportunity. And thank you for praying for me and my family. And I've had so many offers that help me if anything happens. So I really appreciate that too. I just want to take a personal moment, or I should say more moments, since I just took a personal moment, but I want to take a personal moment to say hello to my dad, Herman, and my stepmother, Judy. They came here to support me for Mother's Day, and I just want to say thank you. I love you guys. Happy Mother's Day. I also want to greet my mom. Her name is Star, and my mother-in-law, her name is Phyllis, and I want to greet them. They're going to be watching online, but I just want to say happy Mother's Day to both of you, and I am just so blessed. I really am so blessed to have these three women in my life. And so grateful. So, before I get started on my message today, I just want to ask, because this is kind of our tradition, I would like to ask mothers that are here today in this service, which includes expecting mothers, if you haven't, if you are expecting but haven't had the baby born yet, to please stand so that we can honor you and appreciate you. So, all mothers in the house, stand up. Uh, Thank you. We love you so much, and we appreciate you being here. I also want to, you can sit down if you haven't done so. I just saw that in my notes. See, I wrote everything out, people. I also want to say, I know that Mother's Day is a wonderful day. It is. I am a mother, and I experience that, and I am so thankful for all my children that I have. I'm so thankful for the parents that I have. But for some, Mother's Day can be a very painful day. It can be a very painful day. And this can be true for many different reasons. It can happen because maybe they're estranged from their family, right? That would be very painful when you are celebrating Mother's Day. Or maybe they want to be a mother. That is their heart's desire to be a mother. Yet that hasn't happened yet. And that is a painful thing to have happen. And then many, 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 many of us have already have lost our mothers, that they have already gone home to be with the Lord, and there's grieving there, or maybe even lost a child, right? All of those things can happen, and when they do, celebrations like today are difficult. And so I would really want us to just take a moment in the service to remember all those that have already gone on to the Lord. I don't really want clapping, but if this is you, that you have lost a mother who is no longer with you today, if you would be willing to stand and to honor them and honor their memory, I would like that if you would do that. Yeah, that's a lot. But aren't we so thankful that we had them as long as we did, right? And that we do have great memories too, and we can honor them, whether they're here with us now or we will be with them later. So thank you so much. You may be seated. I just want to say one more thing about that. I wish that I could have the perfect thing to say to people to bring them comfort who is hurting, don't you? That there's times that you know your friends or your family is hurting and you just wish you had the right words to say. But even though I don't have those exact words to bring comfort, I do know someone who is comfort, right? He is our comfort, our shield, our protector, our deliverer, our salvation, our joy, and his name is Jesus. And I just pray that he will comfort all those who mourn today, because he says he will. That is in his word, that everyone who is here or anyone who hears this message online or later will be moved, not by my words, but by his words. I pray that he will encourage and inspire us all, that his words will penetrate our hearts and our minds, and that we will be changed because of him. And that's what I'm believing for. I really am so thankful and honored to be asked to be here. It is a little nerve-wracking, obviously. Anybody who saw me in the hallway is like, that girl is cray-cray, because I was like running around like a chicken with its head cut off because I was just so full of energy and nerves. But it's okay, because I know that my God is here to help me. I know that this is purposeful, that this is not by chance, that everything happens for a reason. And I am meant to be here, and I'm meant to share what he has given to me. So I hope that you enjoy this and that it ministers to you and changes us, because that's what I want. I want the word of God to cause us to be different, to be more like him, to be closer to him, whatever it is. And the word of God can do that. So when I was trying to decide exactly what to preach, because I don't have a curriculum, and I wanted to know what to do, Dennis talked to me, and he said, well, honey, why don't you just start off with searching with the word mother in the Bible? And so that's what I did. I got online, thank God for online Bibles, and I just typed in the word mother, and it pulled up all the scriptures in the entire Bible that had the word mother in it, and it was around like 300 verses, and I read them. I read each and every one of them, and I just read through them with no intent other than to see if anything struck me, anything popped out. And it did. It really did. As you might suspect, there are so many known women that were called mother in the Bible that are very well known. Eve, to start off with, Sarah, Rebecca, Naomi, Ruth, Hannah, and of course, the Mary, the mother of Jesus, right? And all of those women have such wonderful stories, and I could have easily pulled from any of those. But today, I want to focus on a mother whose name wasn't even given. She was never given. We do not have recorded her name. We don't have her son's name recorded. We don't have her husband's name recorded. What we have is where she lived. What we have is what she did. What we have is what she said. We know her by her actions, her words, but we don't know her name. But in essence, we know her because of her character. The Bible referred to her as a wealthy woman. That's how they referred to her, a wealthy woman. Another version referred to her as a notable woman. Still another version called her a prominent woman. This is all the same verse. This is right in the very beginning when they were describing her. And the King James Version called her a great woman. I like all of those. The reason that there's different translations using different adjectives of this one Hebrew word is because oftentimes in languages we have more than one meaning for a word, right? We do that in our English language. And so these men or whoever was translating the Bible, they tried to interpret what they were trying to say about this woman. The Hebrew adjectives, if you pull it up, which I did, they really mean wealth. It means piety, meaning devotion to God. It also can mean renown, that she is prominent. See, can't you get those now? Can't you see why it says wealthy woman, prominent woman, notable woman, right? Because it's talking about all these different adjectives. And it can actually be a little bit of all of those things too, right? I mean, it can be a mixture of them. I do believe this woman had money. You're going to find out. There's evidence in the scripture that she did. But I don't believe that it is her wealth is the reason why we're reading about her. I don't think that has anything to do with it. I think that we are remembering her because of her devotion to God and her character. I think that's what made her notable in that town. That's what made her be in this scripture for us to read about. And it seems appropriate on Mother's Day to remember this woman, a mother who loved God, she loved her family, and she loved others. And when Jesus was asked, what is the greatest commandment in Mark 12:30, his reply was, what? I know you guys know this. You must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength. And the second is equally important. You must love your neighbor as yourself. No commandment, he said, no commandment is greater than these. And that is what she exemplifies as we read this. You're going to see that, to love God, love people. That's what she's called. That is what she was called to do, and that is what she did. And God did amazing things in her life. So our text is found in 2 Kings 4, and it's going to start at verse 8, and it's going to go all the way to verse 38. Now, we're going to go old school, people, because I don't have any slides. I'm not techie. And my goal was to get this sermon written, not worry about the slides. And Dennis was going to try to do it, but, I mean, he is so busy. I'm like, honey, no. We all have Bibles. We all have phones. And I will try to read this scripture slowly. So if you want to join me and know where I'm at, again, it's all going to be in 2 Kings chapter 4, starting at verse 8. So here we go. One day, Elijah went to the town of Shunem. A wealthy woman lived there, and she urged him to come to her home for a meal. After that, whenever he passed that way, he would stop there for something to eat. And then she said to her husband, I am sure that this man who stops in from time to time is a holy man of God. Let's build a small room for him on the roof, and let's furnish it with a bed, a table, a chair, a lamp. Then he will have a place to stay whenever he comes. How specific she was about what she's going to get him. I mean, we're not just building a room, honey. We're decorating it, too. And, you know, so I think there are some women that are decorators. Not me. But you would understand that. And you can see probably why I say I do think she was wealthy. I mean, to just up and say, hey, let's add on to our house. And let's get all these things. I think that her and her husband did have money. But what stands out to me is not the ability for them to, or the ability to build a room for Elijah, which Elijah really represents God. I mean, that's what she said. He is a man of God. He is representing the Lord in this story. Not only do they have the ability to do it, and I think that's wonderful, but that's not what stands out. It's the desire. It's the desire to do it. Right? He didn't ask for that. He didn't even ask to eat. She saw him and invited him in. And then she recognized, she discerned, this is not a false prophet, because according to commentaries that I read, there were several false prophets at that time. She discerned that this truly is a man of God, someone who loves the Lord, and we need to welcome him in, right? And I just want to stop because you know what? That is us. We do the same thing when we recognize who Jesus Christ is. We say, come in. Come into our homes. Come into our rooms. Come into our hearts. Come into our lives. We want you to be with us. That's what we do with salvation. It has nothing to do with status or wealth. It has to do with our spirit. I think that this is why she is someone who is renowned, who is notable, who is great. It isn't her person. It is her faith. And we are the same. We can be renowned. Not because of our status, because of our jobs, because of our things. We can be renowned because of our hope that is in Christ Jesus. That people can look at us and say, there's something different about you. What is it? And you know what it is? It's not because I'm just a nice person, because sometimes I'm not so nice. It's because I have a Savior who loves me. And I have assurance because I know that he is with me. I don't have to be anxious and worried so much because I know whatever happens, he's there with me. We can be that kind of person. All right, I'm going to pick up on verse 11. So one day Elijah returned to Shunem. By the way, that is where she lives, and she's often referred to as the Shunammite woman, if that rings a bell to you. And he went up to the upper room, and he said to his servant Gehazi, tell the woman from Shunem, I want to speak to her. And when she appeared, Elijah said to Gehazi, now tell her we appreciate the kind concern you have shown us. What can we do for you? Can we put a good word for you to the king or to the commander of the army? And imagine if somebody asked you that. What if Jesus said, hey, you want me to put a good word into for you? What would you say? Well, what she said was, no, my family takes good care of me. Now, that phrase is actually an idiom that they used. It really just means that she's content. She's content. And I think, I just love that. Here she is inviting the man of God into her home with no desire to have something returned. Does that happen very often? I mean, that this idea that she just wants to welcome him. She just wants to bless him. Do you think that when she said that she was content, that that meant she had no needs or desires? What do you think? Do you think that when she says she's content, it's because she has everything? I see lots of heads nodding no. Oop, there went my water. I'm just going to let it go because I'll probably kick it again. Does contentment only come when everything is going your way? Can you be content when things are kind of cray-cray and not going your way? Well, here's Paul's answer to this question, which is in Philippians 4, 11 through 13. I have learned to be content. Not I am content. I have learned to be content, whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation. Whether I'm well fed or whether I'm hungry, whether I have plenty or in want, I can do, and join me if you know it, all things through Christ who strengthens me. That is true contentment. Contentment is not based on everything being perfect or that we have everything we want. Because here's the truth, there's no such of a thing. I have never met someone who doesn't have something that they might could need, or if they have everything they need, that they might want, right? That there's always something there. There are times of plenty for us, and there are times of needs. I agree with Paul. That can be true whether you're wealthy or poor, right? There are wealthy people that might not have problems with money, but they have problems, other problems. Problems are not solved solely by money, right? That we can have problems. There is problems with having a deficient, not enough money, right? But there's also problems that have nothing to do with money. Relationships, jobs, coworkers, fears, anxiety. All of that can happen no matter what your status is. So Elijah did not accept this answer that she gave him. He asked his servant if she needed anything, and he wanted to bless her, whether she asked for it or not. He wanted to find a way to bless her. And don't you know that God is the same? He wants to bless us. He says so in his word, that he wants to bless us and that it brings him great joy. In Jeremiah 29:11, he tells us, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." I think that is saying he wants to bless us, don't you? Philippians 4:19 says, "And my God will supply every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus." Ephesians 3:20 says, "Now unto him who is able to do abundantly above what we could even ask or think." This is the kind of God that we serve, right? And this is exactly what the Lord did for the Shunammite woman. So I'm going to pick up on verse 14. Later, Elijah asked Gehazi, "So what can we do for her?" And he replied, "She doesn't have a son, and her husband is an old man." "Call her back again," Elijah told him. When the woman returned, Elijah said to her as she stood in the doorway, "Next year at this time," because he is a prophet, so he's prophesying, "next year at this time, you will be holding a son in your arms." Wow, don't you think she would be like, "Whoa, that's amazing, that's awesome." That's not what she said. This is what she said. "No, my Lord," she cried. "Oh, man of God, don't deceive me. Don't get my hopes up like that." But sure enough, the woman soon became pregnant. And at that time, the following year, she had a son, just as Elijah said, right? God, they're not leaving because they're upset with me. As you know, we're having a Mother's Day meal, and they're going to be our servers. So we thank you for your service as they go on. God gave her what she didn't ask for, yet it is what she longed for, right? He knew her heart's desire even when she didn't. And I love how honest she was and candid to Elijah. I mean, she really spoke from her heart. She, in other words, said, "Don't promise me this if it isn't true," right? "Don't do that. I accept my life as it is. I'm content. Don't give me hope, because with hope sometimes comes possibility of disappointment," right? He's like, "Don't give me hope unless you are going to really do this. I don't want my hopes to go up and then come crashing and burning down." But we can speak truthfully to the Lord. He knows what we're thinking anyway. Somehow we deceive ourselves that if we don't say it, nobody knows it, including the Lord. And that's not true. It isn't a lack of faith or a lack of trust in the Lord to be honest about your doubts. I think sometimes we as Christians don't want to say because we think it says we lack faith. But that is not true. To me, it shows more trust to be honest with God and to give him our questions, to give him our thoughts and not try to hide them. He is the one who gives us the answer. He will calm us. He will help us. He will teach us. He tells us in his word to ask, to seek, to knock, and just keep doing it until the answers come. Just don't stop. How many of you have ever done that? You've asked for something over and over and over and over and over, and you might get tired, or you might think, surely he's sick of tired of hearing this. But he's not. This is his word. These are his instructions. And now she's had this baby. This would be a perfect time to stop our sermon and say, thank you, God, for your many blessings, because he is. He did bless her. But let me just ask you this question. Does life stop when we accept God into our hearts and blesses us? Does our life stop? No. Does everything go our way? No, 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 no. Life can turn in a blink of an eye. Just like that, like yesterday, everything was wonderful. And then today, it is desperate. It happens. That happens. It could be a lost job. It could be your health. It could be a death. All of these things, and even more that I'm not even naming, that life is hard. Life is hard, and it can happen quickly. Just because we love the Lord and we are Christians, it does not stop tragedy in our life. It does not stop heartache or trials. God does not promise you a life with trials. In fact, he says the very opposite. Listen to his words that he told his disciples in John 16:33. I have told you all of this so that you may have peace in me. Not in your circumstances, in me. Because here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. Many trials and sorrows. But take heart, because I have overcome the world. And our peace is not in our circumstances, in our answers. Our peace is in the Lord Jesus Christ. So this was true for her. She has this beautiful baby boy, but she is about to experience such great sorrow. Verse 18, one day when her child was older, he went out to help his father who was working with the harvesters. Suddenly he cried out, my head hurts, my head hurts. And his father said to one of the servants, carry him home to his mother. So the servant took him home and his mother held him on her lap. But around noontime, he died. She carried him up and she laid him on the bed of the man of God, and she shut the door and she left him there. She sent a message to her husband and she said, send one of the servants and a donkey so that I can hurry to the man of God and come right back. Because the man of God did not live in Shunem. They built him a room because he would pass through there. He mostly spent time in Carmel. Why go today? He asked. It is neither a new moon, nor the festival, nor a Sabbath. Why are you going to church, in other words? Why are you going? There's nothing happening right now. And what she says is, it will be all right. That's all the things she says to him. So I just want to stop because this has to be the most hard thing. She literally held her child, and he passed away in her arms. Can you imagine that? That happened. Honestly, I can't imagine it, and honestly, I don't even really want to imagine it. But I know there are people here in this congregation and who will hear me that you can imagine it because it has happened to you, that you have lost a child. And there's no greater loss, in my opinion, as a parent than to have your child be taken away from you. But there's a saying that says, trouble will either drive you towards the Lord or it will drive you from the Lord. Have you ever heard that? That is something that really can happen. It's hard. Hard things are hard. But this woman, it did not drive her from the Lord. It drove her straight to him. She went. So she's 24. She saddled her donkey. She said to the servant, "Hurry, don't slow down unless I tell you to." As she approached the man of God at Mount Carmel, Elijah saw her in the distance. He said to Gehazi, "Go to the woman from Shunem. She's coming. Run out to meet her and ask her, 'Is everything all right? Is everything all right with you, your husband, your child?'" Her answer was the same answer that she gave to her husband. "Yes," the woman told Gehazi, "everything is fine." But when she came to the man of God at the mountain, she fell to the ground before him. She caught hold of his feet. Gehazi began to push her away. I mean, imagine, she just told him everything's fine, and now she is literally collapsed at the feet of Elijah. And he says to her, "Leave her alone. She is deeply troubled, but the Lord has not told me what it is." This is the second time she has said, "Everything's all right," or "it will be all right," depending upon your translation. It really is a Hebrew word that says, it's shalom. We've heard that word, shalom, right? It means peace, or sometimes they say, "Peace be unto you," right? That it is a way to greet someone when they're asking you a question. And I think in this case, this was a way to give assurance to the ones asking the question so that she could get to the one who had the answer. They weren't the one she wanted to talk to. She knew where her answer was coming. It was coming from God. That's who would give her the answer. I mean, she is commendable. This woman is amazing, in my opinion. She has such strength and such determination. She knew who she needed to get to, and he was 15 miles away. So this is not an easy journey that she took. And they were going as quickly as possible. You heard her. She said, "Don't slow down. Just keep going." But I just want to apply that to our lives, because it's not an easy journey for us too. Whether you are going through grief, or whether you're going through heartache, or whether you're going through disappointment, or whether you're going through hurt, taking that journey and walking through that is not easy. Even though she was strong, it doesn't mean she was okay. Right? Doesn't mean that she was okay. Clearly she was not. She fell at Elijah's feet, and he said those words, "Leave her alone. She is deeply troubled." So even though she has this look of like, it's going to be okay, everything is okay, she is hurting, and she is being strong. She is going to the one. But just like courage is not the absence of fear, it's facing those fears. Strength is not the absence of struggle. Strength is facing our struggles. It's walking through them, each and every hard and painful step. And for us who are Christians, it is trusting in God, even when we don't know the answers. Even when we don't know the outcome, trusting him to help us no matter what. Now, I haven't lost a child, thank the Lord, but as you know, and I had cancer, and that is hard. That is hard to just hear it, just to hear, "Yes, you have cancer. Yes, it is fast growing." These are things that are hard to hear. And I'll just admit it, when I first heard it, it was super hard. And I love the Lord with all my heart and soul, and I do depend upon him. But that doesn't mean it doesn't shake you. It doesn't shake you that something has happened that you have no control over. I didn't know what was going to happen to my life. I didn't know what the length of my life was going to be here on earth. I didn't know what the future held. But guess what? I still don't know what the future holds. None of us do. None of us do. There will be times that we don't understand what is happening. How many of you have ever said that? What is going on? Or why it's happening? Why is this happening to me? Why is this happening to my loved one? And when those times come, don't let it shake what you do know. Sometimes we focus on those things that we don't know. And it's like a movie reel just in your head that says over and over, why, what? I can't do this. I don't know what I'm doing. And it's like we are just in a ship that is just rocking us, rocking our world, the shifting sand type of thing. But here's the thing. We have an anchor. We have something. We have someone we do know. So when those times come and you don't know, grab hold of what you do know and stand on that. This is what I know. God is with me. I know He will never leave me or forsake me. I know that He is a God that bears my burdens. I know that He listens to me. He says He wipes our tears. His word says that He walks with us. He talks with us. He helps us. So even though I didn't know what was going to happen to me, I still don't know. I mean, I know that I'm cancer-free right now, thank God, but it doesn't have to just be cancer. We don't know what's happening in our future. But this is the truth that gave me peace. You remember how we pray, Lord, give me peace that passes understanding? How many of you have even said that? Give me the peace that passes understanding, because it doesn't make sense to have peace when you might have a possible death sentence. Right? It doesn't make peace. It doesn't make sense to have peace when your child is gone. But this thing I know, and this is what I said, and it brought me peace. It really did. I know the Lord gave it to me. I said, this one thing I know. I don't know what my future holds, but I do know who holds my hand. And He does. And I'm so thankful that we get to have the Savior every day, every moment. We get to have communion with our Creator. We're not getting on His nerves. He wants to have, He wants all of us. He says so in His Word. My favorite scripture, and I've said it many, many times, anybody who's in my Sunday school class, I'm sure can quote this, Isaiah 41, 13 through 14, for I am the God who takes you hold of your right hand and says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Don't be afraid, I myself will help you. Me, the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, He helps us. So I'm going to pick up on verse 28. So then she said, did I ask you for a son, my Lord? Didn't I say, don't deceive me and get my hopes up? She didn't even tell him. Didn't even tell him that she's come because her son is dead. She just immediately says, we had this conversation before, and I said, please don't give me something that is not going to come true. Then Elisha says to Gehazi, get ready to travel. Take my staff and go. Don't talk to anyone along the way. Just go as quickly as you can and lay the staff on the child's face. You would think, oh, okay, he's getting ready. He is ready to do something. But that mother did not get up. She held tighter to Elisha at his feet. And she said these words, as surely as the Lord lives and you yourself lives, I will not go home unless you go with me. Those are some powerful words. But you know what? They were some powerful words. They themselves are powerful words, but they even spoke powerfully to Elijah. You know why? Because he said those same words. He said those same words to Elijah, his mentor, when he was getting ready to be taken up. He said those words. I love how honest she is with Elijah. Another example of being truthful with the Lord on how you feel. Her fears, her anger, her hurt. God is not afraid of our emotions. He made us who we are. In fact, He says, cast all our cares on Him. Not just a few, not just the ones that seem like are mild. Everything. Why? Because he cares for us. Those words, as surely as the Lord lives and you yourself live, I won't go home unless you go with me. Here is how Elisha said it to Elijah. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way to Gilgal, and Elijah said to Elisha, stay here. The Lord has sent me to Bethel. But Elijah said, as surely as the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you. And this vow, as surely as you live, as I live and you live, this is actually a very intentional vow that says, at this time, it meant, I mean this. I'm not just saying this. This, everything that is in my being will keep this vow. Matter of fact, it really just likened to the idea that the true faith in Yahweh, they're saying, that's how strongly I am not doing what I'm vowing to doing. It's as strong as Yahweh himself. That is powerful. So she knew who had the power to help her and her son, and that was Yahweh. And she was telling Elijah, I'm not leaving unless you're coming with me. So he gets up and goes. I'm going to pick up on verse 31. I promise I'm not too far from being the end. Gehazi hurried on ahead and laid the staff on the child's face, but nothing happened. There was no sign of life. He returned to meet Elisha, and he told him, the child is dead. When Elisha arrived, the child was indeed dead, lying there on the prophet's bed. He went in alone, Elisha, and he shut the door, and he lay down on the child's body, placing his mouth on the child's mouth, his eyes on the child's eyes, his hands on the child's hands. As he stretched out on him, the child's body began to grow warm again. Elijah got up, walked back and forth across the room once, then he did the same thing. He stretched out again on the child, but this time the boy sneezed 7 times and opened his eyes. Verse 36, Elijah summoned Gehazi, call the child's mother, he said. And when she came, Elijah said, here, take your son. Take your son. She fell at his feet and bowed before him, overwhelmed with gratitude. And then she took her son and she carried him downstairs. This God who created life where there is no life, he is the same God who can restore life that is lost. Don't you agree? Nothing, no one can stop. Are too far gone that God can't reach them. This notable woman, or this great woman, displayed so much character through her actions, don't you agree? She was kind, she was hospitable, she was content, she was discerning, she was honest, she was strong, not physically, but spiritually strong, she was faithful, she was determined, and she was grateful. But this woman, that's all those wonderful, beautiful things, she was also deeply troubled. She was also sad. She was hurt. She was probably angry. I think the way she spoke to Elijah when she said, why did you even do this? I already told you not to do this. So she had anger probably, and she had fears, and she had hurt. She has all of these things, right? Yet through it all, did she stop believing? No, she held on to her faith. She held on to her belief. She believed in God. She put her trust. She put her troubles. She put her fears. She put all of these things she put her son's life into his capable hands. And she literally held on to him and on to her faith. Let's do the same. That's my challenge. Let us do the same, right? In good times, in bad times, grab hold of the Lord. Grab hold and don't let go, because I can tell you this, he's not letting you go. You don't let go. Paul said it this way in Romans 8:38 through 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor demons, neither the present, nor the future, nor any power, neither the height or the depth, nor anything can do what? Anything in creation, nothing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is Christ Jesus. And David, he wrote it this way in Psalms, where can I go? Where can I go that your spirit is not with me? Where can I flee from your presence? If I ride the wings of the morning, or if I dwell in the farthest oceans, even there your hand will guide me. Your strength will support me. I could ask the darkness to hide me. We do that sometimes. We hide. We hide from our friends. We hide from our fears. We hide from the Lord. But this is what he said. Even the darkness cannot hide me from you, right? I could ask the darkness to hide me and the light around me to become night, but even then the darkness I cannot hide from you. To you the night shines as bright as day. Darkness and light are the same to you. Aren't those beautiful? He's got us. He said he holds us by his right hand. He said he wants to bless us. He says he's there for us. But we've got to hold on. We've got to grab hold and not let go. He's there for us. Oops, I was like, Lord, am I about to fall down? But no, it was my thing. I thought vertigo was coming back. I started this sermon today saying, I wanted to focus on a woman whose name was never given, right? I don't think that's an accident. Do you? Do you think that the Lord forgot to write her name down? I don't think it's an accident. I think it's she doesn't have a name because she is us. She is humanity. It's not just a woman. It's not just a mother. It's humanity. It is us. We are people who need the Lord. People who love and believe, yet are scared to even hope. People who have faith, who have trust, yet experience great loss and sorrows. You are not alone. Sometimes we like push things away and we feel so lonely that no one understands. No one is going through the exact same thing. And maybe that's true. Maybe they cannot understand or go through the exact same thing as you, but you still are not alone. The Lord is with you. He will help you. And we are with you. We are here to help you. We are a body of Christ. We are here to lift each other up, to encourage one another. I am here right now telling you, sharing with you the truth, which is God loves you. God is with you. God wants to be in communion with you. That is his desire for us to have a close relationship with him. God is faithful. God is trustworthy. If you have never asked him to come into your heart, like this Shunammite woman did, today can be that day. Today, it's very simple. You just ask him, just like her. You just invite him, come, come. That's what you say. And he will come. He will come. He will bless you and he will call you his own, and you will never walk another day without someone beside you. But maybe you're here and you're a believer. I think there's many of us here are believers. But this sermon is for us too. Maybe you have questions or you are going through something terrible and you want to know, you have those whys and whats and hows. You might be feeling grief, anger, fear. Hear what you need to do. Go to God. Be honest. Be honest with him. Be honest with yourself. Lay it at his feet and trust that he is going to walk you through it, because he will. I'm just telling you through my own experience, I know he will. I know he will. He will walk you. I don't know how long it'll take. I know that he will never leave you or forsake you. So he will always be with you, but you will get to a place of peace. You will get to a place of hope and love and joy again. He is a good God, and he cares for you. He loves you. He wants to have a close walk with you. Ask him. Ask him. So I just wanted, I'm going to close right now. But I just want to pray. If you don't mind, you don't have to stand. You just stay seated. If you bow your heads, close your eyes. And I'm not going to ask anybody to come up because it's not part of my thing. But I just want to know. And really, I want you to know. I want you to be mindful and be honest with yourself. Nobody's looking. Is this you? Maybe you haven't asked God into your heart in life. Would you raise your hand? Or is this you and you're going through a hard time and you need the Lord? You need him to answer questions. You need him to be beside you. Can you raise your hand? Yeah, of course. All right, let's bow our heads. Lord, I love you. I thank you so much. I thank you for who you are. I thank you for your love. I thank you for your presence. I thank you that you are a God that we can count on. I pray for each person here who lifted a hand that needs you. We all do. Whether they lifted their hands or not, we all need you, Father God. And I pray for these particular needs that are heavy on their hearts, God. Answer those questions. Come alongside them. Give them peace. Give them hope. Give them answers, Lord. I know sometimes the answers are not what we want, but they are answers. And here's the truth. You are with us always. Till the end of the days. I pray that they will feel your right hand holding them tight and your hands wiping those tears. I pray, Jesus, that you would give them joy and love unspeakable. Be with us this day. I thank you for it. I thank you for your love, your word. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, it is time to go. We're almost ready. Sorry, I guess I'm much more winded than Dennis Boyce is, because we're getting out a little bit later than he normally does. But I just feel like it was what the Lord wanted me to say. I just want to invite you. We are having food down in the cafeteria or gym. I think it's in the gym. So please join us down there. We would love to have you be there with us. Let's end this by saying our declaration. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. We'll go with God. I love you guys. Have a wonderful Mother's Day.